I'm gonna start with you, and I don't want to put you on the spot, but let's say you're a GM and you've got to draft one player, and every player has been drafted except for this guy or that guy. Who do you choose?
Oh man, really?
I could name a lot of players for.
That's a tough pick.
It is.
Do I have to pick it?
Well, you don't have to. Ultimately, don't have to. I didn't think you actually would even get this far in the answer.
No. Okay. Good.
What do you do if you've got a player who's not bringing it?
Sometimes as a captain, whether you like it or not, that's probably part of your responsibility. When you're trying to talk to guys, it's just kind of almost empowering them to in a way set an example and be a leader and feel like they have an important part, an important responsibility on that team to begin with.
How often does a goaltender do that? Pull a player aside and have a talk with them?
If you see there's lack of focus or concentration, maybe you bring it up in a nice way, but for a goalie, you don't want to get too involved in how the team is playing. You know, my job is to stop the puck. I'm part of the team, but I get that a lot. You know, when you want it so badly, you want to win so bad, but in the end, you can hear it sometimes. Just stop the puck and, don't get too involved.
Is that what happens to the goalies?
No, they don't get a fair shake too much, the goalies, yeah. But, they're good. They have so much pressure on them. And, a guy like Flower with our goalie, I mean, the way he competes and, he's got enough to worry about. I don't even know how he would be able to worry about anything else. He's got so much to worry about there.
So when you do come across, your goalie getting smoked in the press, or, if you had a veteran on your team who's not playing up, and you just hear the pile onto one of your teammates, what does that feel like for you guys?
The media is always looking for little things, especially in a playoff series. As you go along, it gets more and more intense because it really becomes more personal. So if they start writing storylines about someone who's not playing well, especially if it's a goaltender, you make sure that he's not worried about that and no one thinks what everyone else is thinking.
It's been your experience as well?
It's tough because you have to answer that. After each practice, every game, they might bring it up. And you're like, no, I'm playing well, even though they don't think so. But especially for a goalie, I think you have to keep telling yourself, I'm doing the right things. And like I went through a slump last fall, and the biggest thing for me to get through that was pretty much to just stick with it and really believe in what I was doing, even though I didn't have the result right away.
But were you reading like The Secret or The Power of Now?
I did a lot of different things. Try to cook the right soup and everything, eat that.
Whatever it takes. Yeah.
Are you superstitious guys, the three of you?
No. I have a lot of stuff going on.
Yeah.
That's what they say, goalies are a little different, I guess, right?
I think it's just dealing with the pressure and playing every second day, you feel more comfortable, when you're, for me, it's about preparation. So some of it is just routine, some of it is superstitions.
You've had, your coach for a while, changes. We hear from the outside, a coach lost the room. You hear that all the time. Does that actually happen? Can a coach lose a room? I mean, very different kind of coaches, but can a coach?
I think it's tough. I really believe it's tough. I think you hear that a lot when a team's losing. But I mean, team's losing for probably a lot of reasons. I don't know if that's the case. I would find that pretty tough. I think guys are pretty motivated. Guys want to win, for sure. There are times where things get heavy and that kind of thing when you're losing. But I would find that pretty difficult, I think, for that to happen.
What do you think?
I think in the locker room, when you're not winning, sometimes you start looking for excuses. We're not, just looking in the mirror and say, okay, we need to be better. Sometimes you take the easy way out and start pointing at things that might be easier to maybe criticize.
What scares you on the ice?
What scares me on the ice? Probably missing a chance. Yeah. Really? Yeah, you want to score, you want to create. I would say that scares me. I don't like doing that.
How about you?
I guess I'd have to say the first thing that comes to mind is the being in those big games and making defensive mistakes and up in your own net. I think that's like the type of thing that takes away your offensive confidence a little bit and really makes you second guess everything you do after that. So I'd say that's probably the one thing I have.
Do you have a play that haunts you, that stays with you in your career?
Not yet.
What about a Shea Weber slap shot?
That was scary.
Get out of the way. Get out of the way.
It's pretty wild, right?
It's not pretty. I always tell the story. In 2010, it was game 6 against Nashville. We ended up closing out the series in that game, but it was, we had 3, 4, 5 penalties in the third period, and we were protecting a 1-goal lead, and they had a 5-on-3 power play against us, and we all know where the puck's going in that case. But I lost the faceoff in our zone, and thank God, all I could hear was Brent Sopel screaming, "I got Weber," the whole time. So I was like, okay, I got the heck out of the lane. And I think he must have teed up 3 or 4. And one of them didn't go in, I don't know. And I think Sopel might have blocked 3 of them. And yeah, he had ice bags everywhere after that game. But that was his thing. He loved to block shots. And thank God I was out there with him, because it might have been me. And I might not be sitting here today. So
is it smart for every player to block a shot? I don't think it is. But is it smart? I'm not. Is it?
Well, it's a technique.
We talked about this, but I don't know.
Guys are good at it. They don't get hurt as much, maybe, but
not everybody's that good at it, right?
No, it's timing, I guess.
For sure.
You know what? I'm kind of split, because when I played junior, my coach always told me he didn't want me blocking shots. You know, it was just, he's like, that's why we have a goalie. Yeah. You know, so I didn't really argue. I didn't really argue with him. But. Yeah, now it's different, just the way you play defense. And if it's a shot he's going to be able to see, and you don't really need to put your foot in the lane and risk missing a month, then you probably don't do it. But you also don't want to be the guy flamingoing if you need a big block either. So just knowing the situation. But I don't think until I got to the NHL that, you know, I started kind of focusing on that a little bit more.
All right, so you have Sid the Kid, Captain Serious, and the King. Who here hates his nickname?
Oh, no. It was okay. It was okay early on, but yeah. It's probably stuck around a little longer than I thought.
That again? You don't like that again?
It could be worse, but it's sometimes it makes me a little uncomfortable. Yeah, and people are like, well, why do they call him the King? And it's like, well, if my name was Daniel, I don't think they would call me King Daniel. It's like Henrik is an old royal name, and that's why I think it all started.
Your hand went up right away.
I think that. It was pretty clear where that question was directed, am I right?
No, it was at all of you guys.
Oh, right.
Yeah, sure. It was all of you guys. Who's got your number? Is there one player in the league when they take the puck? You're like,
I don't want to talk about that.
Do people have your number?
There's a few guys that probably have a good chance of scoring if it's a 1-on-1.
Yeah.
But again, as a goalie, you keep telling yourself, I got this, even though you don't. But
what about you're sitting there in a big game and you see that there's a player breaking away with the puck and you know that that player happens to be him? What about that?
You know, when you face top guys like these two, it's about, you know, being patient. Try to let them make the first move, because they can always read you and see what you are about to do. So, you know, I try to wait them out a little bit, but
it's not giving me anything right now. I'm just looking for a little something, just a little bit.
Maybe there's an international hockey game. Maybe you're sitting on the bench watching the play.
Is he thinking blocker? Is he thinking glove? That's all I want to know. But he's not giving me anything.
I'll wait for them to say something.
Yeah. Is there a goalie that you don't want to come down against?
If I'm ever in that situation, I guess I'm just happy to be there, get the chance, you know. I guess maybe my chances are not as good against some goalies, but I got him thinking that already. So already maybe I'm in his head. We don't know.
I've seen the highlights. It's always 5-0. Just on the toe there, on the stick, right there.
How's the culture of the game changed since you started?
You know, hockey is a kind of old school mentality, and things should be the same way always. And I think it was like that until the late 90s. And now 2000, after the 04 lockout especially, you see more rule changes to make the game better. And just the way I think the league is advertising the outdoor games, there's more things happening. And I think we're opening up the eyes to a lot of new fans. And I think that's a great thing. And being stuck in one corner, I think that's good.
Even though there isn't an out player in the NHL, the You Can Play campaign was really, really powerful. And then, you know, you guys are leaders on your team, and there will come a time where there'll be an openly gay player in the league. And that's probably going to come sooner rather than later. Do you think that's an important part of the evolution of that culture?
Yeah, I think things like that happen. And at first, it always might seem like a shock. You know, it's great to see progress like that. It's great to see paradigms in the way we view things, especially professional sports, change. And the way, you know, Henrik just talked about the way we can progress as a game, if we can tailor to all sorts of people watching, especially in the United States, and grow our game, that doesn't hurt anybody. It's great for hockey. It's great for us.
And what do you think? If you're a leader of a team, that's your team where it happens. You know, you're going to get the questions.
Yeah, I don't think the questions are the, I mean, you just, it's what's right, I think. And, you know, it's about your group. And I think the questions are the last thing you worry about. You make sure that everyone understands. And, you know, that's what it's about. You know, it's about everyone playing, enjoying the game, and no matter what. That's easy. I think that's the easy part.
Yeah, I think when it comes to hockey players, the respect we have for each other, opponents or teammates, I think it starts there. So it would not be an issue at all. You know, it's important that everyone feels in that locker room, whoever you are, whatever you believe in, we're doing this together.
Thanks, George. Thanks a lot. Yeah.